Hi, how y'all doing tonight? I just want to make a quick correction before I start. The program said that I was to speak about the legality of the case, but just to clarify, there is nothing legal about what is happening to Russell and Maroon Shoats. And just going forward for any other public events about this case, about solitary confinement, about mass incarceration, or any other core features of this imperial system, we're only speaking about the illegalities of this, about the criminality of it all, or if we use the word legal, it should be in one of those quotes to indicate that it really means something else. By way of introduction, I want to say that I'm honored to be speaking here on behalf of Russell Maroon Shoats, that I want to give my shout out to Teresa and to Sharon, to the family, to let you know that I'm always there for you, whatever you need. When I joined the Human Rights Coalition, which was co-founded by Russell Maroon Shoats, I did so specifically because they identified as an abolitionist organization. My work with prisoners in Pennsylvania has led me into law school in order to learn the devil's trade, so I can learn the devil's tools to try to assist in bringing down the devil's structure. And I was asked outside if I'm going to be a radical lawyer, and the answer to that is decidedly yes, and an abolitionist lawyer. And I mean that in the fullest sense of the term, which means these solitary confinement units need to be abolished in Pennsylvania and everywhere else, this prison system and this whole political imperial order. Now I'm going to move on to talk, though, about Russell's case, about his situation, the factual and legal or illegal aspects of it. So, Russell Maroon Shoats has been held in solitary confinement for approximately 30 of the 40 years that he's been incarcerated in the state of Pennsylvania, including about 21 years consecutively. In the 1980s, I think it was 1982 was the last time he escaped from prison, he's liberated himself from prison, not once, but twice. And that deserves a rousing round of applause. After his last escape, though, he was released back into the general population. They didn't keep him on permanent lockdown then. It was only after he was elected to be the president of the Lifers Association that they threw him into the hole for the reasons Teresa stated, because he's a leader, because he mobilizes people, because he inspires people, because he helps them see through the lies in which their lives have been trapped. In 1989, there was a rebellion, they call it a riot, but there was a rebellion at the Camp Hill prison in Pennsylvania. Maroon was nowhere near Camp Hill, he was in Pittsburgh, I think. But nonetheless, they took the leaders, or the perceived leaders, in the Pennsylvania prison system, and they sent them out to the federal system. Maroon was in the federal system in California, right, for about Leavenworth, okay, in Kansas, right? For about 18 months. Well, he was there, he was in general population, there were no problems. He got back to Pennsylvania, they put him in the hole, he hasn't been out since. And just to be clear for those who don't know what that means you're in your cell 23 or 24 hours a day, that you have very limited visitations. He's buried in the southwestern corner of Pennsylvania. He has very limited social interaction, very limited environmental stimulation, access to book, access to literature. If he wants to leave his cell, he's subject to visual strip search. He has to be escorted with handcuffs and shackles everywhere that he goes. When he goes out on a visit, it is a non-contact visit, and he is in handcuffs on the other side of a glass screen. I saw him 2 weeks ago, and despite these soul-crushing conditions that are designed to break people, his optimism, his sense of confidence, his sense of humanity, his intellect, and his political forward thinking, as Fred Ho was discussing, was phenomenal. It is truly remarkable. Over the last 20 years since he's been in solitary confinement, I'm going to get into some of the policies and some of the procedures that are used in the Pennsylvania Department of Corrections, then move to the legal analysis. He is subject to review of his confinement status every 90 days. Every 90 days they tell him basically the same thing. You're an escape threat. You're an escape risk. You're a danger of escape in a less secure facility. It's the same thing. These hearings are meaningless. Last year, there was a push by Teresa and other supporters to pressure the department to release him to the general population. During this time, Maroon was given a psychological evaluation, right, to see if he can, you know, pass in general population. He was asked, what about this plan to take over a prison in the 1980s? And he said, I don't know what you're talking about. And the woman told him, you shouldn't deny that, which was odd to him. He has no idea what that is in his file that is following him around. And Maroon never had any intention of taking over prisons. His MO was always to try to get the hell out of the prisons. Excuse my language, maybe I shouldn't say that in the church. I'm sorry if I misspoke. That plan to take over a prison was also mentioned by the superintendent of the prison when meeting with an advocate. The superintendent said, I can't let him out. He's a leader, he's an organizer, he's engaged in hunger strikes, he planned to take over of the prison, right? The superintendent also indicated to this advocate that it's not just me that wants to keep him in here. So that either means he's referring to central office that oversees the entire Department of Corrections, although central office seemed to be indicating they're fine with him being released. Not that you can necessarily trust anything that they say. And or it also means that it's Department of Homeland Security and its people that are part of the federal government's national security state that want to keep him locked in these control units. And I'm going to return to the context of control unit confinement and the de facto national program of torture that's going on in these solitary units. Now, I'm going to discuss a little bit about the law because I think there's a big problem within a lot of social justice movements. I should say the problem with lawyers who work with the social justice movements who tend to not discuss the law or discuss it in ways in which people that are participants can understand, and it's this technical specialized area of training, and that's problematic. Law is the discourse of institutionalized power, and it is one of the primary mechanisms through which this system is able to impose its will and continue to oppress people. In service of that 1% that Maroon was talking about. So there are two particular constitutional grounds that are relevant in assessing Maroon's confinement. The first is the Eighth Amendment's prohibition on cruel and unusual punishment. Now, the Supreme Court and lower courts have said that solitary confinement per se, that being locked in these little cells 23, 24 hours a day is not cruel and unusual in and of itself. I think, first of all, we should understand that this judicial interpretation is on a par with the 19th century case Plessy v. Ferguson. Is anybody familiar with Plessy v. Ferguson? That was the case in which the Supreme Court said white supremacy is not really white supremacy. It's separate, but it's equal, and therefore it's legal. Here the Supreme Court is saying torture is not really torture. It's disciplinary custody. It's an administrative measure. It is permissible. It's not torture. It's about that level of seriousness, right? In order to prevail on an Eighth Amendment claim, if a case were to be brought on behalf of Maroon, he would have to demonstrate that he's being deprived of a single identifiable human need, right? The identifiable human needs that he's being deprived of are environmental stimulation, social interaction, sleep. Maroon is an insomniac due to not being able to sleep because of the constant banging, because of the noises of prisoners who are losing their minds around him, because of the 24-hour illumination in his cell, not being able to turn off the lights. His health has suffered as a result of the extraordinary levels of stress inherent in solitary confinement. He has had heart palpitations. He has had to deal with cataracts in both of his eyes. He has had hypertension and a host of other issues that are not being appropriately treated. They won't be appropriately treated in the prison system in general. And if you're in solitary confinement, then it's even that much worse. So in order to prevail on a claim, he has to make a showing that he is being deprived of these human needs. Now, the core of solitary confinement, the core human needs he's being deprived of are environmental stimulation, social interaction. In the case of the Angola 3, for those who want to look into this stuff some more, is a very important case on that. There's a lawsuit moving through Louisiana, which is going to trial soon, in which the court recognized that environmental stimulation, social interaction are human needs. These are important precedents to set, and we need people bringing cases on these issues. The other issue, constitutional issue that's relevant here is the due process issue. You can't deprive somebody of a liberty interest unless you give them due process. So this means all these hearings that Maroon gets every 90 days where they just rubber stamp the thing and say, you're an escape risk, when the only person that's escaped from a Pennsylvania prison in that I know of recently only escaped because he was driven off the grounds by hiding in a compost bin, right? People generally don't escape from prisons. It's not in Pennsylvania any longer. So this is all boilerplate, meaningless reviews that he's being given to hide the real record evidence, or the real reasons, which have to do with his, not just his political perspective, but the fact that he's an effective political organizer. So, one last legal aspect that is very critical is the international aspect and the human rights aspect. Now, the United States government's record in recognizing and adhering to human rights is abysmal. They violate every single treaty that they ever signed or pretended to adhere to, and the Convention Against Torture is no different. Lately, the United Nations Special Rapporteur on Torture has been very active around the issue of solitary confinement. Teresa is in contact with him about her father's situation. He was contacted and very responsive to the case of Mumia Abu-Jamal whenever the Department of Corrections wanted to warehouse him in solitary after they kept him on death row. And the Special Rapporteur on Torture did not say that solitary confinement by itself is cruel and is not, you know, cruel or inhuman or torture. He said more than 15 days, based on the scientific literature, then that's either torture or cruel or inhuman or degrading treatment, depending on its effects on people. That's 15 days. You know, not 30 days, not these 90-day reviews that Maroon gets, not this 21-plus years he's been in there. 15 days. So we need to continue to bring this case under that framework and continue working to impose a human rights framework on the United States government. Now, Maroon's case is going on in the context of a de facto, what I said earlier, de facto program, a national program of torture of prisoners. Right now, there is anywhere between 80 to 100,000 prisoners in solitary confinement cells in county jails and state prisons. Real concisely, the purpose of all of this. Solitary confinement is used to terrorize the prisoner population. The prisoner population is used to terrorize communities of color and poor communities more generally. The socioeconomic conditions in those communities are used to terrorize the middle classes. And the middle class's role in society is to carry out the economic, social, and political agenda of the ruling class. This is the architecture of empire. This is the importance and the political significance of these solitary confinement units, right? There's 80 to 100,000 people that are in there right now, but if it were 80,000, then 79,990 of them there are all there as window dressing so that people are not able to see that the real reason these units are developed are to repress people like Russell Maroon Shoats. People who would resist and persuade others of the righteousness, the legitimacy, and the necessity of resisting this empire. So I also want to talk about the context of these units in Pennsylvania and the work the Human Rights Coalition has been doing the last 4 or 5 years. We've documented thousands of reported human rights violations, most of them in solitary confinement units. There's about 2,500 people in solitary units in any given day in Pennsylvania. We have been instrumental in getting a Justice Department investigation into abuse and torture of mentally ill prisoners in SCI Crescent, and we continue to hound them day in, day out, and week in and week out by issuing reports and trying to publicize this information so that those on the inside who are resisting, and there's plenty of them, are not forgotten and their voices don't go unheard. Just last week, we got reports that a prisoner at the State College in Pennsylvania, the state correctional institution in Brockview, State College, Pennsylvania, was actually murdered by prison guards in a control unit. They pumped his cell full of pepper spray after he had a conflict with staff who were depriving him of food. They filled it with so much pepper spray that he was completely immobilized. They went in there, they beat him, and they tasered him. And he's dead now. And his name is John Carter. And later today, when you see me, try to come up to me and ask to get my email, because we're going to be sending reports about this, and we need to make sure that this brother who was fighting against this system from the inside and who was murdered is not forgotten. Right? This is very much related to the struggle to free Maroon from solitary. Right. Also of significance in Russell's case, in continuing to bring this pressure to bear on the DOC, is that we have secured a meeting with the Secretary of the Department of Corrections that Teresa and her sister are going to go on, along with other advocates. And this is one important step that we're going to be reporting on to supporters to see if they're moving on this. But we should be clear that until and unless they free him from solitary confinement, whatever moves they're making, they're trying to fool us. They're trying to delay and deflect any pressure. And before I go, I just want to say, in terms of getting involved, don't be surprised if in a couple of months, a couple of weeks, maybe a few months, we're going to be calling for mobilizations where we don't just need five people to go visit with the Secretary of the DOC. We need 500. We need people coming from New York City and from Philadelphia and from Maryland and up from DC, from Pittsburgh. We need to reach out to the people that are struggling to free the Lucasville Five in Ohio and from all over, and we need them to mobilize on the Department of Corrections in order to let them know that until they free Russell Maroon Shoats, they're gonna have problems. They're gonna have thousands and tens of thousands of problems of people that aren't gonna give them any slack or any rest.